Good afternoon, Velocipedians. Well, if you're looking for excitement and adventure in this video, scroll on. An exciting video this is not going to be. I'm actually in the workshop just doing some sorting out. But so many of my viewers are into the Sturmey Archers and the hub gears and such like. I thought I'd just bring you along for this little sort through my box of hubs. I did mention recently that I would have a look in my box of hubs for something for someone, and I got this comment saying, "What? Box of hubs?" So yeah, this just accumulates really. And if you were watching my last video, you'll know the reason why. I'm kind of going through taking stock of what I need to keep and what I need to get rid of. Get rid of will be partly sell, and what's left and I don't want can be donated to a bicycle scheme, a community bike project or such like. Anyway, this is the box that I just pulled down off a shelf that's full of my hub gears. Not quite all of my hub gears. There's another box there as well. That's an interesting one. The Sachs Orbit 6x2. It's a hybrid transmission with a 6-speed freewheel. We could have a 7-speed on it. And a 2-speed hub gear and a drum brake. I think now that, actually it's all dusty. Now that triple front rings and such like are kind of going out of style, and people are going to this mullet setup with huge 12-speed cassettes with 46 inner and that sort of thing on the back, and a single chain wheel. There's something to be said for these hybrid transmissions. They can be fitted to an older bike. Sachs started with this 6x2, then they went to a 7x3, which was a 7-speed freewheel with a 3-speed hub gear. And then they went to a 9, which was called the dual drive, when they'd been bought out by SRAM. So there was the Sachs Orbit 6x2, the Sachs 3x7, then that became the SRAM 3x7 and the SRAM dual drive. They're excellent and worth looking out for if you don't want to be faffing around with a front mech. You still have two shifters. You have your hub gear shifter, usually a thumb shifter or a twist, and then you have your derailleur shifter. Of course, you can set it up in the traditional old-fashioned mountain bike style of the two grip shifts or two thummies. Anyway, that looks very dismantled, but it's not. It's just got the axle pulled out of it. They can be popped back together easily enough, but that's in a box of its own because it's a little mini project doing that. I'm putting it back on the shelf. If I end up not doing it, then I can sell that just in the box as it is. Cogs, 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 lots of them. Sprockets rather, including my default 22 tooth to change from Dutch gearing to sensible gearing. A few old stock indicator rods. This is just bits and bats really. Triggers, 4-speed there, an upside down 4-speed there, and then lots of more modern ones. There's a nice old one there, which is a 3. Just the accumulated detritus that everyone collects if you are around any hobby for a long time. Right, that's kind of a separate drawer. And it goes into a metal drawer cabinet, that one. This is the meat and potatoes in here. Now, this is just spares, back plates, brake assemblies, brake shoes of different sorts. That's got something written on it. Something front and rear. It's a new one, a new old stock. And I pulled it out of the drawers at Skidmore's. That even looks as though it might be a moped. There were quite a few moped spares in those drawers. Autovap being one of them. Autovap and Rally moped spares. Might be one of those. Or it might be out of that big hub. What is that? That's modern. We'll have to see if the rest of that is in there. Not all of these hubs are ones which I took out of a bike or disassembled and just put in here. Some of them are just from job lots, from clearing out the shop and that sort of thing. Here's a Shimano Nexus assemblies which go onto the dedicated hub which has these splines on it, and you can use the hub with or without these brakes. So someone has removed them from a hub, probably a Nexus 4-speed or something like that from the 90s. This is an Arai tandem brake. It's a drag brake. It's not meant to stop the bike. You're meant to have it on a friction lever. On our tandem I had a thumb shifter, a friction, you know, down tube brake lever basically, and I had the friction set fairly tight so I could pull the lever on and it would just bite the brake and just provide friction to slow you down. And that's what it's for. It's for slowing the tandem down on long hills, just to stop it running away. Hence all this metal work around here, that's heat sink. And it screws on to the opposite side of a screw on freewheel. So if you've got a flip-flop hub or a tandem hub with two screws on, that goes onto there. Now, this is the accumulation. That is something that's been dismantled. Oh, it's a dyno hub internal. That's probably no good now, having been separated without a carrier. A set of internals for a Sturmey. For some reason there is a stray brake lever which wants to go in there. From a drum brake. This, oh, this is just a coaster brake. Nothing exciting. Nothing to see here, folks. It's just a new old stock coaster brake. And I noticed a couple more coaster brakes. This is a nice one. What's that called? Oh, it's Fichtel and Sachs. Comet with a K. That's why I couldn't read it. F&S. Fichtel and Sachs, which is the company that became Sachs, Sachs Ure, etc. Fichtel and Sachs is the branding that you'll see on the Duomatic two-speed automatic hub, which I have in a bike, but I don't have a spare one in here. Bits and pieces, bearings and such. That's pretty wrecked. That is a three-speed with brake, which will be an AB, A for three-speed, B for brake, same shell as the AG with the dyno hub. Looking at the writing, I'd say it's 80s, early 90s. There we are, 91. That's probably come out of a Dutch bike. In fact, it's come out of a Gazelle, because this particular chain tensioner here is Gazelle specific with this plastic shape. Getting hard to get. I have a supplier, but with Brexit it's getting hard to get them across the channel, so I'm going to keep that out and put it with my chain tensioners. It's worth coming in here already. Right, put that one down. I'm just making a line of the different hubs, sorting them into types. I can see what I've done here. At some point I've put alloys in that end, steels in this end, so the old stuff's down here. I do have a Sturmey Archer K-type hub as well, which I need to fish out, because the Humber that I'm about to renovate has a knackered K-series hub, and I hope to be able to use it. Another, that's a Shimano coaster brake. I'll put that nice coaster brake with it as well. Feeling the two side by side, the quality of the Fitzel and Sachs against the Shimano. Probably different grades. This is probably just a low grade, bang it on anything city bike hub. But this one, just the bearing quality, it's got a lovely feel, and of course it's got a grease nipple on it as well. All right, here we have 1985 Sturmey Archer 3-speed AW. Good condition, been taken out of a wheel. Now as I go through these, Sturmey Archer AWs are available. Ask me for what you want. You're going to see quite a lot of AWs from this era. So I've got plenty. Don't pay a fortune on eBay. Just email me or message me in the comments, and I'll sort you something out. Another thing to note. Note the different number of spoke holes as well. That's something you need to specify if you ask me for one. This one looks like it'll be a 36. That looks like it'll be a 28. This is probably out of a Rally 20 or one of those. This is... it's always fun to date them. Here we are. 83-8, August 1983. 38 years old this month. And we have another, which is there we are, 82-6. So if you've got an 80s bike, I can probably get you a hub that will match the date more or less. This is another nice coaster brake. This one's a Sachs. Lovely, lovely. Nice quality. And this one is a 93. March 93. That's late for a 3-speed. And it needs a bit of lube. That one is taking out and freeing off. I'll put that to one side. Dismantle that and free it off. It's usually an easy thing to, once you pull the internals out, they tend to be just waiting to free themselves, really. 1978, August 1978. That's got a lovely feel to it. And the plastic oiler. I'd build that into a wheel for something, definitely. Now, this is the smooth shell, and it's a 1956 April. And it is an AW, 3-speed still. This is 40 holes. It'll be out of a Roadster. And it's got, it's probably got 40 holes if you were to count them up. British bikes used to have 40 holes in the rear wheel, 32 in the front wheel, almost as default. Continental bikes were usually 36, 36. Eventually, of course, in fact, I'd say the rest of the world were 36, 36. Eventually, the British caught up and fell into line with the rest of the world. This is an August 1991 Sturmey Archer 5-star. So this is 5-speed, double-ended. I've no intention of using it. That could be available if somebody wants it. Nice for a rally sprite or something like that. I think some Hercules commuters used it as well, I'm not sure. Still got its cog on this one. It's got an early type of drive side nut on here as well. Look at the square cutouts. I think that's possibly not a Sturmey Archer nut, I'm not sure. It's obviously on here because it's one of the earlier threads, cycle thread, which is finer. Now then, what do we have? It is a Sturmey Archer, it is an AW. It's got a plastic oiler, despite being a smooth shell, and it has no dating. So we, in the Rally Rodster Club, we have a dating expert, Neil Edwards, and we've got people like Jack Edward as well, who are good at that sort of thing. If someone can give me a clue, please. This looks like it's going to be a Shimano. It is, it's a Shimano 3S. Smaller body with this nice kind of, you hear that? Lined finish on it. Very small cog. Plenty of spoke holes. Don't know what that might have come out of. Not necessarily something that I've broken up, as I said. Now, dynos. Here we have, this will be an AG. It is an AG, which is three-speed with dyno. In fact, I've written on this one, 1961 three-speed. Yep, 1961, October, smooth shell, missing its oiler, and feels fine. Can't really tell, because you can feel the magnets, but you can't tell much apart from that while holding it like this. And that is 40 holes. So that's come out of a Superb, I'd say. That will have probably come out of a Rally Superb, and hopefully we'll end up back in the, oh no, three speed. So, a Dawn Tourist, something like that. Something that's got the dynamo, but only got three speeds. Yeah, maybe a Dawn Tourist, rather than a Superb Dawn Tourist. Something of that ilk it's come out of, I'm sure. This is a slightly tatty 1954 AG three-speed. And this has, once you get back in age, they have the number of spokes stamped on here, on the flange. So that's a 40. That's come out of something similar. Something three-speed, so not a full Superb. Notice the dating experts will point out that there are different covers on the dyno hubs as well. You get the Bakelite ones or the metal ones. I'm not an expert. I'm sure the dating people can tell us all about that. This is another AG, and it's got its patent numbers listed there, and it's 1958, July 1958. The surface crap, but actually that'll clean up, and the chrome's a little bit pitted there, but it'll be fine, and it has 40 holes again. Now this is an unfortunate one, because the plastic's cracked here, broken off the Bakelite, so the dyno hub internal part on this one may be useless, may be repairable. As I say, I'm not an expert in dyno hubs. This is a dyno 4, it says. I think that was quite early. That's diamond with dyno 4 in it, and it is a 1951 January 1951. Right, crack on, we don't want dead air. Ah, this one's dynamo has been removed. This is possibly that one that's in the tub by itself. This is another one with the diamond dyno 4. This is 1950, April 1950, this one. And it is also 40 holes. So that's, these last two have come out of nice early Superbs. And this one's had 4-speed written on. 4 Rally Superb written on it as well. That looks like more likely to be a 36 hole, this one. There's no stamp with the number of spokes on it. Maybe it's a little bit later. It's a 61 and this has got the Sturmey Archer and Dyno 4 written there, but it's an FG, F for 4, G for generator, and yeah, 61.2, there we are, February 1961, a little bit of a bash on there, but neither here nor there, I'm sure. Right. I'm just having a look back at this 1950, I'm just curious. Yes, yes, this 1950 has the screw-on freewheel. You see, it doesn't have the three tabs and the retaining circlip. So that's the earlier fitting. You'll watch out for that one if you think you're just going to swap a sprocket over and then you find out it's got one of those. Yeah, there's the later fitting. This is only a year later and it's got the fitting that we know nowadays. Right, that's all that old stuff. Apart from a front dyno hub, this will be a 32 or a 28. It's a 32 spokes. And yeah, can't even read the stamps on there, other than Sturmey Archer. Nice little clip over the oiler. Ready to go back in a bike with 32 spoke front wheel. Be a nice conversion on something that doesn't already have a dynamo. And now we have a variety of front drum brakes. Now I like front drum brakes, I'm a big fan. As you've probably seen, I've put them into all sorts of things. My beloved old Claude Butler Tourer, a Majestic, it was around 1980, I think it was, gold. It was a little bit after that, it was about 85 now I think about it. They came in blue, I had a blue one, surf blue, that was lovely. But I had this gold one that had belonged to a friend who died not long after I'd got it from him. And gold with red mudguards, which is how he bought it. And I knew the people he bought it from, I knew the lady he bought it from, knew at the shop. I knew its history. Anyway, I converted it to these Sturmey Archer alloy drum brake hubs. What a lovely bike that was. And I sold it. I still can't believe to this day that I sold it. I sold it to a friend and colleague, but yeah, my gold Claude Butler. So that had one of the rear drum brake hubs. I'm looking for one because I'm sure I have one. The rear drum brakes with a freewheel. They're a bit, oh, there's one, staring at me. These are uncommon to find now, where you've got the drum brake with a freewheel. So this is what you would put in a touring bike or something like that. Long axle in this one's probably been in a tandem. Ideal for a tandem, really, because you can have this running as friction, like I showed you with that tandem brake, and then have your normal rim brake on the back as well, so you've got two brakes on the back. So that's, these are really, I just think they're really, really effective brakes. I love the modulation on them, the feel you get from them, and the bearings are super high quality. And that's something that didn't deteriorate over the years. Sturmey Archer and Sachs are the two main manufacturers. Shimano always seemed to go to the roller brake, which I didn't like. This is a Sachs, so it's got a bigger and more complex reaction arm. Here's a Sturmey front to compare with it. I find that looks a bit cheaper than that one. Both of them require the bracket on the fork or the clip incorporating the bracket on the fork, which you can buy cheaply. They'll both fit into the Sturmey Archer, one of those. Same width, same flange diameter, clearly built as rivals for each other. There's even a similarity, particularly with this flange, even a similarity in the way that the flanges are made. But the back plate on the Sachs sticks out a lot more. I just find that's a little bit messier, but it's still just as good a brake. It's an excellent thing, and that would be a perfect front wheel companion to that Orbit 6x2 rear hub that I showed you earlier. It'd be nice to build a bike up with that pair, particularly a continental bike. An old Koga or something like that would be lovely with those two. Or RIH or something, RIH as they call it. Worth pointing out, look, two types of casting on these Sturmey Archer hubs as well. This is the posh one. I think it became known as the Elite at some point. And this is one of the more modern incarnations, this one, the XFD, made by Sunrace since the takeover. So this one's 2000 and something. And it's got this lovely curved profile to the flange. More metal there as well, so better heat dissipation, which is what it's for. And of course, with these tall flanges, you've got shorter spokes, you've got a steeper crossover, so you've got a stronger wheel. And this is just something I've just pulled out of the box, not being lubricated or serviced. Goodness knows how many miles it's done, and listen to it. You can't listen to it, can you? Because the bearings are absolutely beautiful. XFD, this is a late British one. This one with this graphic on it. It's a bit of a period piece. Missing its internals, but I've got plenty of internals there. So I just pop the brake in, give this a bit of a honing out, wrap some sandpaper around the drill, and around the inside of there. I'll do it by hand. And this is one with the flat flange. Just needs a little tweak up on the bearing. There we are. It's not been cinched up on the lock nut, so I can do the bearing by hand. These arms often rust. This one's been repainted. You get different types of actuating arms for different cable arrangements. The one I prefer is the hooked one. I'm looking for one now to show you. There's one that's like a hook over. There's one on this Sachs. That's the cable that has a little red plastic thing that sits in there. And I'm looking for another better one to show you. This one you can put an eye bolt in and use a conventional ended cable. But you still need... The cable will come down the fork, then there's a fulcrum which slips into here, and then you've got the inner, and they have a long adjuster on the correct cable, but you can, with this end, you can use a standard cable as long as you've saved your fulcrum to go on there, and then you put an eye bolt in here, but you don't have the length of adjustment that you do with the correct cable, which has a great big long adjustment, about 50 millimeters long. And this is an Elite VT. I don't know whether there's any difference between an Elite VT and any of the other names they call them. I've never found a difference at all. Elite implies it's some kind of premium edition, but it doesn't seem to be. It doesn't seem to be any different quality whatsoever. Here's another modern XFD. Again, something I've just pulled out of the bin. Imagine if that had the weight of a wheel on it, how long it would be spinning for. Not even being lubed yet. In fact, it would probably spin less readily if it was greased, because the grease would drag it. That's from something else. What is this from? It is an Atom, this one. That's interesting. That's just something that's found its way into the box, obviously. Nice little look at how they work inside. The lever pulls on a cam here, and as the cam turns around, it just expands. Like any drum brake from the early days of automobile engineering, right through motorcycles and mopeds and into bicycles. The same principle, it just worked, basically. There are some which would have two cams. You don't tend to find them on bicycles. On motorcycles, they have two cams, and so you get two cams turning, and it pushes out both ends here. And sometimes you even get one end fixed, the trailing end, which is the wheels going around the last end. So it's the front part of the shoe that hits in both instances. That's called a twin leading shoe. This one, because it's this end on both of them, as the wheel's spinning, one of them, the leading edge is hitting first, one of them, the trailing edge is hitting first. On a higher spec, you get twin leading. And that's in the days of sporty motorcycles and cafe racers, a twin leading shoe front brake was the thing to have. Except the useless going backwards. Brilliant going forwards, useless going backwards. I seem to remember my Vincent having something like that. I just love doing that. It's just almost therapeutic. So again, this is a late British one. And a housing from 9th of 2000. So that is very late British one, at the time that they were sold. It's a nice complete one in lovely condition. And after that brief foray into date stamping, they've stopped putting anything on this one. And this hasn't even got the weight of a wheel on it. So you get a wheel and a tyre. Imagine this is a bike upside down, you spin the wheel. I could make a 20 minute video just of the wheel going around. And again, not even serviced as it came out of the bike. Look at that. Wonderful. If you're a geek for things like that, you'll know what I mean. This one's all loose and maladjusted, but it's another of the same. And we have one last. Now, this is the big mystery hub. It's a beautiful thing. I don't know if it's ever been in a bicycle. I don't know if it belongs in a bicycle or whether it belongs in a classic moped. Or a utility tricycle or something like that. It seems to say, it's indistinct, it seems to say Excelsior. My view of this finish on here, it smacks of something modern trying to be old, or something modern made to the old design. It just, this finish looks a bit cheap to me. I'd almost prefer to see it painted. The quality of the chrome is good. The quality of the bearings is good. But then it's probably brand new inside. But as you can see from my hand, and I've got big hands, it's bloody huge. Could it possibly be Indian for use in a rickshaw? Or a cargo trike? They don't tend to. They tend to have fixed wheel single speed. They don't bother much with brakes, and they have rod brakes when they do. So I really don't know what this could be from. It's obviously from something with a single front wheel anyway, because it's a front hub. So classic moped. You know, of the Velosolex type. I'm not saying it's Velosolex, just that kind of thing. The lightweight mopeds. Anyway, I'm thinking this would look rather stunning in the front of my Path Racer. My old Gazelle Path Racer, which is a single speed coaster brake. I need to build a front wheel for it. The front rim looks scruffy. It's got non-stainless spokes in it and just a crappy little hub. No brake, which is illegal in the UK. If I were to take the Path Racer abroad with me when we go away in the motorhome, then I'd be legal, but on British roads I'm not actually legal with the one brake. So I've been thinking of building this into the front of the Path Racer. Too much, do you think? A bit ostentatious? too bling. Maybe if I painted the back plate black. Interesting clevis arrangement for the cable. So you need a nipple on this end of the cable, as well as the lever end. And the cable obviously goes up through this guide here. That will be a stop for the outer. This, I mean, what's this? Obviously mates with the fork and goes onto a clip around the fork, but why does it need to be adjustable up and down? If this is a rear hub, I could understand, and it goes like that and gives you a bit of adjustment. I don't know. Mystery hub. So there we are. A little one-take tour through the box of hubs. Very geeky. Don't expect anyone stayed all the way, but there we are. Well, this may have been boring for everyone else, but it's been useful for me. And I've got everything stacked back in the box in some kind of order. I now know that I'm short on Sturmey Archer ABs, which is the three-speed with a rear drum brake. I need to accumulate maybe one more of those, because the one that I've got is horrible. That's this one down here. So, yeah, I could do with accumulating another Sturmey Archer AB for a Dutch bike. And I'm also out of the old style of Sturmey Archer front brake. The steel type that looks like a dyno hub. But it's actually, so it looks pretty much like this. But it's actually got the brake in here. You can't use this same shell because there's an insert for the braking surfaces that goes into a brake hub. And of course this has the holes for these retaining bolts as well. So I'm surprisingly short on old style drum brakes. I must have a look through my wheels and see how many I've got in wheels. I mean, I can see one from here in a wheel, which is there. So I've probably got some in wheels. Just disturbing to find out I haven't suddenly got something, which is a bit of a staple when you do Dutch bikes. So anyway, there's a lot there that's available if I can help anybody out with any, particularly if you're planning a drum brake conversion. I would thoroughly recommend doing what I've done to my green Superb, my 83 Superb, which is to put one of these in the front of a normal roadster. It really does improve the bike no end. Consistent braking in all weathers, no squeaking, juddering, anything like that. So let me know if you want anything. You can mention it in the comments. Probably better still if you email me at thevelocipedium@gmail.com. I'll put it in the description. And oops, more bits, still more bits and pieces. And that can now go back on the shelf. Thank you for watching this little interlude. I'm sorting through a few boxes. There is an exciting one here. Vintage lighting. That needs sorting out into headlamps, tail lamps, dynamos, reflectors, into smaller boxes. There's some interesting things in there for those of a geeky persuasion such as myself. And let's face it, we're at the end of this video now. You're the only people who are left. Okay, see you again soon. Bye-bye.